Hello everyone. Today I'm going to read a little bit from two different articles on why do people gossip. These are not from narcissism sites either, but you're going to see some incredible comparisons and the reasons why narcissists go on their smear campaigns. Aside of that, they just love the destruction. We have to add that part, which really isn't in here that much. But I'm going to read from that. But first, I wanted to do a little housekeeping. Now, yesterday's video, I talked about how I won't blame my parents, and I want to put that in context because I know that there's people here who are no contact with their parents, and a parent or parents or siblings. Family members are making their life a living hell. Blame your parents in that case. They're 100% to blame because I know some of the stories and it's an absolute nightmare. The context I wanted to put it in my reference was my parents are gone. They both died fairly young, 52 and 58, some time ago. So they're not even here anymore. And that's not the issue. The issue is, so they, well, basically, they can't do any damage. And they wouldn't, not really, not to the level that I read and hear of other YouTubers' parents doing. My stepfather, no way in hell. He had an absolute rule, and that's where I get my discipline from. Absolutely no gossip. You just never talked about people. And if he caught you doing it, you were in big trouble because he knew. He knew how damaging that could be. So we didn't do it. Not that other people didn't do it, but we just weren't going to be a part of that crowd, and we weren't. My mother left her own devices now. If it wasn't for my father, she'd be out there, chatting away, as narcissists do. But under his influence, no, she wouldn't do it as long as he was alive. So it was nice, and it was a very peaceful life, not having all that nonsense in your life. So, the context I was referring to myself was the movement for calling victims of narcissists codependents. There's something wrong with you. You have to dig up your childhood, heal those old childhood wounds, blah 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 blah. That's what I was talking about for me. I'm not going to go into therapy and heal my childhood wounds and spend thousands of dollars and many more years hoping someday I feel good about myself because I am fine. I actually do like myself. Thanks to the narc, I've realized what an incredibly strong person I am, incredibly resilient, and incredibly smart. He had taken me down so far that I could barely tie my shoes or figure out what I was going to eat for lunch. But I clawed my way back to sanity and found out, you know what? I can do that. Not everyone can do that. He certainly wouldn't have been able to do that, that's for sure. So that's the context I meant it in. I'm not going to spend another minute in therapy. I'm not going to spend another minute digging up the old crap, healing myself, because there is not going to be another significant other in my life ever again. Never, ever, ever. And I'm a person who used to say never. No, this time I mean it. Once I'm out of this mess, So, I think if you've heard all my rants on codependency and therapy and all of that stuff, you probably understood what I meant, but I didn't want to be offensive to people who have parents they really need to blame and really need to stay away from because a narcissist will do massive amounts of damage. So if your parents are alive, they're near you, and they are a narcissist and they're wreaking havoc, blame them 100%. Please. You don't need my permission to do that, that's for sure. But I didn't want to take away from the importance of other people's no contact with their parents. I guess that's what I'm trying to say. I hope that made sense. That said, back to the articles. The first one is from whydopeople.net, and I'll post the link in the description box below. Why do people gossip? Obviously, there is no sole reason why people enjoy bad-mouthing others. There are a lot of people who crave for approval and attention, so they resort to gossiping about others to get that attention. Indeed, it takes a lot of willpower and discipline to refrain from gossiping or spreading a rumor, especially if you are the only person who knows some juicy information. Those who know something always wait for the right moment and the right crowd to share it with. Being the center of attention simply gives them satisfaction. Among many reasons why others talk behind others' backs is filling in the void during conversations. When it gets silent in a group, it is as if everyone becomes scared of silence. Whenever there is a lull moment, some just could not understand that it is a natural thing. They tend to be anxious, so they fill in the void by gossiping about somebody. The query, why do people gossip, can also be answered by the fact that some people lack general knowledge. Now, this is interesting. I found this one very interesting. People often start to specialize in a particular profession from an early stage, thus limiting their knowledge. If they lack other interesting topics to talk about, they resort to gossiping. If the topic discussed is beyond their profession, they shift to talking about other people to conceal the fact that they couldn't contribute to the conversation. Now, this is really interesting because my narcissist, and I'm pretty sure everyone else can relate, a lot of narcissists are very uninteresting. They pretend that they are. But I have a lot, for speaking for myself, I have a lot of interests. I like to read. I love art. I love all sorts of things. I've done all sorts of things in my life. Not nearly to the level some people here have, but I can keep a conversation going on many different topics, that's for sure. And my narcissist wouldn't be able to do that at all because he was the one that specialized in a particular profession at a very early age, and that's all he's done. And he's never really ventured out. He's never gone to college. He was never interested in the museum. I could get him to go to the zoo. He wasn't interested in my friends. I usually have, when I do have friends, I have all different kinds of friends. Just an assortment. It's really hard to get, when I was throwing a party, believe it or not, it's hard to get with the many different types of friends that I had, a comfortable party going, because they're so different. So I really didn't master that area of getting all my friends together, because I don't think some of them liked each other. I don't know. But just to give you an example of how different kinds of people, many kinds of people I knew and were friends with. He's not like that. No, he stays in his own little bubble of his town and only knows certain kinds of people. So any people I don't want to know anymore, that's for sure. So another answer to why do people gossip is to belong to a group. That's why I don't want to know anybody he knows, because I don't want to know that group. If everybody is chit-chatting about a certain someone, it is instinct to join in so you wouldn't feel left out. Gossip is common in schools and offices, so when everybody is a part of it, it feels like a big happy family. Some would rather join in even if they do not feel like gossiping, or they are not supposed to be that kind of person because they badly want to belong and don't want to be an outcast. The common answer to why do people gossip is an inferiority complex. Those who have a low self-esteem are more likely to engage in gossiping. They become insecure when someone is doing better than they are, so they take revenge by spreading rumors about them. Also, people who couldn't confront those who are nasty to them fight them back through bad mouth. Persons with unhealthy self-esteem easily get offended when they are embarrassed in public or talked down to. Since they don't have the guts to be confrontational, they retaliate when the person's back is turned. 90% of the people I've known that are the ones who spread gossip and rumors are, I mean, it's just an incredible number of people who are like this that I've seen over and over and over again in so many situations. Instead of saying, hey, you know, what you just said hurt my feelings, or, oh, that wasn't nice, take that back. Something like that in the moment. I've known so many people that will get you back for just a slight. That would be a narcissist. Something they perceived as a slight. They don't come back and clear it up with you like I was doing in the beginning, as far as context, what I meant for myself in context, not for anybody else. Very common these days. And I think that speaks a lot to the gossiper, because it's like you can't even come to me with the simplest complaint. You know, and I think a lot of people need to work on their self-esteem. That's for sure. Now the next article is evolve to chat. No, I'm sorry. The new word on gossip, and this is at psychologytoday.com by Nigel Nicholson. The link is in the description box below. I'm just going to read parts of this because it's rather long, and it does go into evolutionary psychology, which I think is a fascinating new area of psychology, but for the purposes here, I'm not going to go into all of that. We've all seen both sides of gossip. One side is the warm feeling you get from spending time with a friend and sharing stories about mutual acquaintances. The other side is the stomach-churning anger, shame, and frustration you feel when you realize someone is spreading bad news about you. We want to be on the right side of gossip, but sometimes it illuminates while other times it just burns. Boy, do I know that feeling. Oh my God, I'd be practically vomiting when I realized when people were coming up to me in this neighborhood, saying things to me that made no sense. The only sense it made was that my narc has been talking on a regular basis to a lot of people about me, and I just felt like vomiting. It's just stump that pit in your stomach where you just feel sick. Like, how could you do that? And for the reasons I read in the first article, you know, you start thinking about this person you were with, who you thought was a strong character, supportive, and confident, and it turns out it's anything but. He's anything but any of those things, obviously, otherwise he wouldn't be doing that and have been doing it all along. Networking, something I'm very familiar with, and I happen to be pretty good with. But in terms of, and before I read this, in terms of like networking, helping other people find jobs, talking to other people about other companies in which I'm curious and maybe interested in working. What is this person like to work for? What is this company like to work for? And on and on and on. That type of networking. As social animals, we are status conscious and for good reason. Navigating the social pathways of the tribe requires a good understanding, basics, and empathy of its complexity. There is an extensive stream of research summarized in the work of sociologist Lee Ellis, PhD, and epidemiologist Richard Wilkinson, PhD, showing that among humans, as in other primate species, being of high rank confirms an important array of benefits: health, wealth, and happiness. But attaining these benefits and avoiding failure is difficult. One reason is that social hierarchy is multidimensional. People deploy a wide repertoire of talents to compare themselves with others. What's more, social structure is dynamic. It changes all the time. That was pretty much it under networking. I described my type of networking. Next one is influence. The second function of gossip is influence. Even when our social position is apparently immobile, we retain an active interest in making sure we do not lose it. When we find an opportunity, we try to advance a good opinion about ourselves to those who can help us. However, it is not enough to do good. You need a reputation for doing good for it to count in your favor. Like it or not, we all are confronted with the task of selling ourselves and making sure other people have a positive impression of us. Oh my God. Yep, that's what Narc went after, my reputation. Oh, he trashed it. I'm totally trashed. I mean, my life right now is a massive car wreck. My life is the car that has to be totaled. There is no fixing anything at this point. There's just moving on. the car is totaled. I mean, it's that freaking bad. That's what he's done and he's been doing for the very pathetic reasons that I've been reading about gossipers. Self-promotion is not always a conscious strategy. We do it whenever we meet a stranger. It's in the way we engage in small talk and mobilize our facial expressions to convey interest and sympathetic sentiments. Alliances. Oftentimes, we use gossip for the sake of what seems to be pure one-on-one pleasure. This pleasure derives from the third function of gossip. Alliances. Sound familiar, anyone? Human gossip follows the same asymmetries as a monkey picking lice from another's fur. The weak groom the strong more than vice versa. People supply information to whom they are attracted and with whom they wish to align themselves. When I give you a tidbit of gossip, remember it's a secret. I am also telling you that you are valuable enough to be a recipient and that you should think well of me for doing so. We use this information to form advantageous alliances that we hope will provide some stability and ideally an upper hand to our place in the social hierarchy. When we gossip, of course, all three functions are being served at the same time. Going to any professional conference, which are huge circuses devoted almost exclusively to official and unofficial gossip, and see how people move among their networks, seeking both influence and alliances. To experience a sense of powerlessness and exclusion, go to one as a complete outsider. So true. If that didn't make sense, that's okay. But I know how that feels. Anyway, so I really like that. Alliances is important. Important because narcissists, that's what they do, with their gossip and spreading their rumors and going on their smear campaign. The entire purpose is they're aligning themselves with people who they believe can hurt you even more by spreading more gossip. So it's like the monkey picking another's fur. Just think of your narcissist as picking the lice out of the stronger monkey's fur. Help me, help me. Yeah, destroy this other person. Yeah, and that's exactly advantageous alliances. That's exactly what they're doing to get something they want from you. The dark side. Many people link gossip with malice. Oh, yeah, I do. Indeed, gossip can be vicious. And John can raise his own status with Jane and boost Jane's own sense of self by telling her something bad about Steve, a known enemy of hers. Steve, without even knowing this is happening, can be damaged. But Jane is also likely to go away thinking that Steve's predicament could happen to her. Although gossip can strengthen the bonds within a community, sometimes it becomes a covert contest between winners and losers. In an ever-shifting matrix of alliances, people will always be looking for an advantage, which leaves others at a disadvantage. Negative gossip about third parties, who, of course, have no opportunity to defend themselves, is a dangerous game that can rebound on the gossiper. To be good at malicious gossip requires a high degree of subtlety and skill. The trick is to appear to be sympathetic to the victim while holding him below the waterline with implicit denigration. Most people find this distasteful. Much malicious gossip is conducted unconsciously, an act that requires self-deception. But humans are especially adept at it. It helps us to maintain consistent social performance. Let's see. This is according to Robert Trivers, PhD, one of the originators of evolutionary psychology. In the world of gossip, self-deception often takes the form of genuinely believing one is on the high moral ground of charitable sympathy, looking down on one's slowly sinking victim. Anyone remember that recording? Don't blame me for your downfall, said the narc. And the last one is men do it too. Oh, I found that out the hard way. It is said that women gossip more than men do. Perhaps they only do it better. Men just call it networking. What does tend to differ by gender is the content of the gossip. Men are much more interested in who is up and who is down, hence sports page obsession, as befits their predilection for competitive game playing. Women tend to gossip more about social inclusion and moral alignment, who's in and who has merit. A key element of gossip is storytelling. We have a narrative instinct that is an essential aid to social insight and action, and a great vehicle for learning. Children are irresistibly drawn to stories, and we use them to instill all the most important ideas about the human community, its daily dangers and rules, plus moral fables about how to succeed and be happy. In daily life, we ruminate in narrative voice, telling ourselves moral stories in which we are the hero or innocent victim of some chain of events. In doing so, we consistently make attribution errors, placing a human agent as a key element in a chain of events when in reality, the true cause was something impersonal or random. Interesting, wasn't that? I found it very interesting. See, the whole gossip thing, like I said, when I was growing up, my stepfather, it was not allowed in the house. You were not allowed to talk about people. Here and there, if it was important to know what was going on with someone, but not to maliciously tear somebody down, to make yourself feel better. It just wasn't allowed. It was a discipline that he had, and it was a number one rule of the house. Really, it was, aside of being on time. So I cannot relate to the malicious gossiper. Have I gossiped? Probably, yeah, sure I have. But my rule, like I've always said, is if I'm talking about somebody, it's only their best attributes or something more recent that they've succeeded at and building them up. If it's somebody I don't like, I will just say, I don't really know that much about them and, not my friend. I mean, I don't say it like that, but I get out of the conversation somehow because I don't want to be responsible for that coming back to me. Is when you're a gossiper, it always comes back to you. Have you ever noticed that? I just don't want to be a part of that. But one last element I wanted to point out too is that basically how I am about gossip, the narcissist used that against me. Because he knows I'm not going to go out there and be talking to the other gossipers about gossip. So I won't be finding out who's talking about who and yada, all that stuff going on. How crazy is that? You're a person that minds your own business, and these malignant narcissists will, because you do mind your own business, feel free to wreak havoc and go, oh, she did it. She was the one that said something. She was the one that called. And then you have people come, not really coming up to you, but avoiding you, and they're angry, and you're going, what the hell was that all about? Just know when you're saying that to yourself, somebody's walking by and they're giving you a dirty look, or you don't really know them, or something to that effect, you're starting to feel weird. There's a malignant narc somewhere around, and if you're the type of person that really does like to mind your own business, they're going to make sure that they're going to do their dirty work and blame it on you. That's why my narc has gotten away with so much. He knows this rule, right? That I have. That's why he would always come in the house. Salty earth, quiet guy, not much going on, right? No, there was a lot going on. Yeah. I don't even really want to know anymore because I probably will throw up this time. So, anyway, I hope that made sense and that wasn't too rambling and that helped someone today. Peace out.